Hello everyone and welcome to the final episode of this build series. Today we are going to finish this project. All the parts have been 3D printed, the PCBs have been tested, a couple of bugs have been corrected in the control software, and we are ready to assemble everything. I'm using M3 screws for the housing and self-tapping screws for the PCBs. It's a good idea to use a thread tap on the posts for the M3 screws, since it will make assembly a little bit easier. Okay, I think we are finished. Or maybe not. Using CA glue for the display lens was a really bad idea. The vapor from the glue fogged up the inside of the lens quite badly. I was able to recover it using Tamiya polishing compound, but I decided to make a new design of the lens that didn't require any glue at all. The new design fits perfectly between the OLED display and the front panel. I also adjusted the tolerances of the light guide so I could press fit it into position instead of using glue. While I was testing the concept, I noticed that the tray picked up a lot of dust, so I made a dust lid for it. And while doing that, I also decided to make it a little bit more personal by painting it. I'm using the channel logo as a template for the paint job. And since we are already using black and orange, the choice of colors were easy. Let's take a quick tour around the schematic diagram and I will explain how this design works. If we start with the heatbed PCB, we have the copper traces here with 8 ohms resistance that is used to generate heat. And we also have a temperature sensor that is placed on the heatbed PCB as well. Next, we have the front panel PCB that has 3 buttons and 2 LEDs, one red and one blue. And these LEDs together, they form the activity indicator or status indicator. And finally, we have the control board. On the control board, we have a 12 volt input power connector, and we have a voltage regulator that regulates the 12 volts down to 5 volts. That is basically powering everything, the whole rest of the design. In the middle, we have the Arduino, and here we have the connector for the front panel PCB and the OLED display. Here's the connector for the temperature sensor, and here's a connector for a serial port that is used for debugging and for tuning. On the right side here, we have the switch FET that is used to turn the heater on and off. We have a small LED here for debugging purposes, and that is not, you don't need to use that if you don't want to. And finally, we have this circuit here, which is the current measurement circuit. And it uses a shunt that consists of two resistors of 0.1 ohm each. And we have a differential amplifier that amplifies the voltage over these resistors. And the output is fed through a low pass filter into a buffer stage, which is basically a voltage follower. And after that, the signal is routed to the analog to digital inputs on the Arduino. The current sensing circuit is used to calculate the output power that you feed into the heater. And you can this is optional, so you can actually leave this out and make a small change in the software, and then you use the PWM output from that is controlling the FET transistor here. The benefit of using current sensing is that you are actually calculating output power based on the voltage and the current, so you will get a much more exact value than if you do it like that instead of using the PWM. But the PWM solution is of course much cheaper because you don't have to assemble these components onto the PCB. If we are speaking about accuracy, there is another thing that is worth mentioning, and that is that I use a very simple circuit and very cheap components. And these op amps are standard components, and all the resistors are 5% tolerance. So this will not give a very accurate current sensor, but it's good enough for the purpose that we have, because we are only going to use it to calculate the output power. The design uses an external power plug adapter with 12 volt DC and 2 amps rating. This will give you enough power for heating the water in most cases. The power plug should be a barrel connector with the dimensions 5.5 mm and 2.1 mm, and you should make sure that the center pin is connected to the plus terminal. Another option is to use a small power block like this one. It is possible to increase the voltage to 15 volt DC, and that will give you a little bit more power to heat the water. Depending on the ambient temperature, the heater may have problems to reach 50 degrees Celsius with 12 volts because of power dissipation and other losses in the system. So in those cases, 15 volt is needed. To get the power calculation in software to work, we need to make a couple of measurements. First, we need to measure the resistance of the heat bed. Second, we need to measure the voltage across the heat bed at full output power. So we need to increase the set point temperature until the activity indicator turns red. The last measurement is optional. We are measuring the reference voltage of the analog to digital converter of the Arduino. The measurement is a little bit tricky, so you might want to skip that. So these are the values that we got from our measurements. All we have to do now is to adjust a couple of constants in the software and download it into the Arduino. Okay, I think it's time to do some more testing. The purpose of this first experiment is to check how well the heatbed PCB can withstand high temperatures and how much of it that is transferred into the 3D printed housing. For this test, I'm using a lab power supply to feed the voltage and current into the heatbed to simulate the short circuit failure of the electronics. I have attached one temperature probe to the heatbed PCB and the other one to a mounting post. The PCB seems to handle temperatures over 100 degrees Celsius without any problems, and I don't see any alarming temperature elevation around the post. So I'm happy with the results of this test. Next test is to check the water temperature. I'm using a thermocouple sensor, since this can be submerged in water. Everything seems to work as expected, and I don't seem to have too much loss between the heatbed and the tray. Finally, it's time to make a test similar to the one that I did in the first video. It took a bit over 180 seconds for the decals to come loose from the backing paper. These are cartograph decals from an academy kit. I think that the result speaks for itself. I started the PID tuning by collecting data printed on the serial port to a file that I later imported into a spreadsheet program to plot the graph. This was very time consuming and a tedious way to work. But I was very pleased to find a software called Serial Oscilloscope that reads data from a serial port and plots the values on the screen directly. This made the tuning so much easier. In this clip we see the proportional gain tuning results speeded up 100 times. My approach to tuning was to start with a low proportional gain and increase it until I almost reached the set point temperature. After that, I added a small integral gain to get rid of the steady state error. It turned out that the PID regulator was a bit overkill for this application. A PI regulator does the job just fine, so we can skip the derivative part of the regulator. These are the final tuning parameters for the regulator, and since we have set the derivative gain to zero, we are only using the PI part of the PID regulator. So, will this tool be a game changer for decaling? No, probably not. But it will make decal work a little bit more pleasant and less time consuming. The heated decal bath is a nice tool to have sitting on the bench, and it was a really fun project to do. I had the opportunity to learn more about PID regulators and making my own PCBs with open software tools. The software can be improved a lot for sure, and I will continue to maintain it, because there are a couple of things I'm not totally happy with, but it's okay to use it as it is now. However, I did a couple of shortcuts with the mechanical design, and that is worth to bring up. The temperature sensor is soldered to the PCB, and the component legs works as springs to hold it against the walls of the metal tray. Over time this will wear out and the legs may break, but the separate spring-loaded part made the design much more complicated. Electronics and water is always a bad combination, and there are a couple of gaps in the top where water could get into the housing and onto the PCB, so it's a good idea to be careful and keep this in mind. The maintainability is another topic. Software upgrades and reaching the serial port for logging tuning data basically means that you have to do a full teardown of the housing and the heat bed. So yeah, that's a bit inconvenient. But with that said, I'm still very pleased with the outcome of this project. Thank you for watching. I hope you have enjoyed following this project as much as I did making it. Bye for now.